Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Anna Matteo and Gregory Stockel. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's science report. He explains the causes and effects of last week's historic solar storm that hit Earth. Finally, Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins present the lesson of the day. But first,
the World Health Organization recently authorized a second dengue vaccine. The move could provide protection for millions of people worldwide against the mosquito-borne disease. This year, several dengue outbreaks have happened in places across the Americas. In a statement on May 15th, the UN Health Agency said it approved the dengue vaccine made by the Japanese drug maker Takeda. Takeda's dengue vaccine is known as Qdenga. It was previously approved by the European Medicines Agency in 2022. The two-dose vaccine is given 3 months apart. It protects against the four kinds of dengue. The WHO recommends its use in children between the ages of 6 and 16 who live in areas with high rates of dengue. Approval by the WHO now means that donors and other UN agencies can purchase the vaccine for poorer countries. Studies have shown Takeda's vaccine is about 84% effective in preventing people from being hospitalized and about 61% effective in stopping symptoms. WHO's Rogério Gaspar is director for the agency's approvals of medicines and vaccines. He said it was an important step in the expansion of global access to dengue vaccines. The first dengue vaccine that the WHO approved was made by the drug maker Sanofi Pasteur. The vaccine was later found to increase the risk of severe dengue in people who had not been infected with the disease before. There is no exact treatment for dengue. It is a leading cause of serious illness and death in about 120 Latin American and Asian countries. About 80% of infections are mild, but severe cases of dengue can lead to internal bleeding, organ failure, and death. Last week, the WHO reported there were 6.7 million suspected cases of dengue in the Americas. That is an increase of 206% compared with the same period last year. In March of this year, officials in Rio de Janeiro declared a public health emergency over its dengue epidemic. Brazilian health officials began giving out the Takeda vaccine with the goal of protecting at least 3 million people. Infectious disease experts say climate change and the increased range of mosquitoes that carry dengue are partly to blame for the spread of the disease. I'm Anna Matteo.
religious beliefs in South Korea have been decreasing for years. In 2021, just 22% of South Koreans between the ages of 20 and 29 identified as religious. In 2004, that number was 45%. Those numbers are from the Washington, D.C.-based data organization Gallup. But that might be changing. Social media is fueling an increased interest in Buddhism among young people. Music creator Yoon Sung-ho is one reason for this increase. Yoon said he has received support from younger generations for his Buddhist monk character. He calls the character New Jeans Neem. Yoon said he created the character last year when he was performing at a ceremony to celebrate Buddha's birthday. He wore a hanbo, the traditional Korean clothing that looks like a monk's robe. He said a video of the performance got millions of views on social media. "That's when I thought, oh, I need to make a character quickly," he said. He carefully built his character while seeking support from Buddhist leaders in South Korea. His goal was to balance popular culture with Buddhist teachings. New Jeans Neem is a combination of Sa Neem, a Korean title for Buddhist monks, and New Jean, a name that a senior monk gave to Yoon. Yoon's music-creating character has appealed to many young South Korean adults. And the character has increased young Koreans' interest in Buddhism. Kwon Tu-won is a university student. He attended the ceremony and said he was happy to see New Jeans Neem perform. Kwon told the Associated Press, "Isn't the hairstyle really hip?" He added that his interest in Buddhism also came from the inclusivity and openness of the religion. Yoon said he believes his attempts to break traditional attitudes towards Buddhism has gained support among South Koreans. He said that when most people think of Buddhism, they think of things like sitting still, quiet temples in the mountains, and the sound of wind chimes. People think these are Buddhism, but what I am doing now is the opposite, he said. Venerable Bum Jung is another Buddhist who has been gaining young followers on social media. He is also known as Kotsnim, which means flower monk in Korean. He is active on Instagram, where he communicates with both Buddhists and non-believers. Bum Jung often shares photos of himself with descriptions including Buddhist teachings and his thoughts. People think monks are supposed to be noble. They are supposed to be in the mountains. They are supposed to be purer than anyone else, he said. He added that he hopes to change the ideas around monks and Buddhism in South Korea through social media. He said he receives many messages asking him simple questions about Buddhism. They include, "Are monks not supposed to eat meat? Are monks able to get married?" He has also been asked, "Will you marry me?" Bum Jung said he aims for his answers to be clear, but carefully worded. He said, "I tell it like it is." I'm Gregory Stockel.
Earth was recently hit by the most powerful solar storm in more than 20 years. The storm caused some colorful light shows in some parts of the world, but no major damage was reported. Solar storms can hurt the operation of some equipment on Earth that uses radio waves. This includes GPS services, electrical systems, and satellites. The U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, issued warnings about the storm before it reached Earth on May 10th. In a statement, NOAA said it had observed heavy solar storm activity in the days before. Based on the activity, the agency issued a geomagnetic storm warning. Solar storms can involve two different processes. One is called a solar flare, while the other is a coronal mass ejection, or CME. Both involve huge releases from the sun of magnetic field energy and a substance called plasma. The American Space Agency, NASA, explains that plasma is a form of matter made up of ionized particles. This means the particles have taken in so much energy that it causes electrons to separate from their atoms. Solar flares travel at the speed of light in all directions. They can reach Earth in about 8 minutes. But CMEs travel much slower. They reach Earth in 1 to 3 days. NOAA said a strong solar flare event had led to the latest CMEs hitting Earth. NASA says its observatories see solar flares as flashes of light on the sun, while CMEs are seen as large explosions spreading out into space. The agency examines data from its Parker Solar Probe on plasma flowing out of the sun's corona. Because the latest CME explosions were directed at Earth, they caused geomagnetic storms. NOAA's Space Weather Prediction Center issued a warning calling the storm activity an unusual and potentially historic event. NOAA noted that such storms can cause problems for some communication systems. The agency informed major power operators and NASA officials about the storm activity. The electric power grid can also be affected or disrupted, along with radio, satellite, and spacecraft operations. NOAA noted that severe geomagnetic storms can also produce intense, colorful light shows or displays in the sky. Such shows are also known as auroras. Colorful displays could be seen overnight in different parts of the world. Reuters news agency reported on several areas in Latin America experiencing auroras after the solar storm activity. In Mexico's desert city of Mexicali, pink and purple light could be seen lighting up the night sky last Friday and Saturday. In Chile, Reuters reported local media and social media users shared photos of the sky in the city of Punta Arenas, where the lights took on red and purple tones. Local media in Argentina also reported similar displays in the Patagonian city of Ushuaia. The French news agency AFP reported social media services were filled up with people publishing images of auroras from areas including Northern Europe and Australasia. Ian Mansfield lives in Hertford, Britain. He told AFP, "We've just woken the kids to go watch the Northern Lights in the back garden, clearly visible with the naked eye." Other people also compared the intense color shows to the Northern Lights. Sometimes also called aurora borealis, the Northern Lights are natural, colored light displays that sometimes appear in the night sky in the most northern parts of the world. From Australia's island state of Tasmania, photographer Sean O'Riordan published a message on X explaining what he saw. "Absolutely biblical skies in Tasmania at 4 a.m. this morning. I'm leaving today and knew I could not pass up this opportunity." People in the United States were also able to see colorful auroras, including parts of the West Coast and as far south as Alabama. The most intense solar storm in recorded history happened in 1859. It mainly produced auroras in Central America. A severe geomagnetic storm in 2003 cut power in Sweden and damaged power transformers in South Africa. Storm activity coming from the sun generally intensifies as it reaches the height of a repeating 11-year solar cycle. The activity increases as the sun experiences magnetic field changes that affect its polar areas. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his science report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for joining me.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, you reported on some severe solar storm activity that reached Earth last week. Your report mentioned that even though this storm was the most powerful to hit Earth in over 20 years, no major damage was reported, correct?
Yes, that's right. No serious damage was reported in the days immediately after the storms, and this appears to still be the case. Experts say these kinds of storms can affect several things that use radio wave technology. These include GPS, power systems, and satellites. But several U.S. government agencies, including the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Department of Energy, said they were not aware of any major problems related to these solar storms.
There have been some reports about SpaceX's Starlink satellite internet service being affected by the storm activity. What can you tell us about that?
Yes, there were some reports of this, and SpaceX chief Elon Musk also addressed the issue on his X social media service. And while he said the company's satellites were under a lot of pressure because of the storm, in the end, they seemed to hold up well and none were lost. Now, a couple of years ago, SpaceX was not so lucky. Another powerful geomagnetic storm affected Earth, and the company lost about 40 Starlink satellites. That damage, though, seemed to happen because the satellites were launched at nearly the exact time the solar storm was occurring.
Okay, thanks so much for joining me, Bryan, and thank you for your report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
Hello, my name is Anna Matteo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In a recent Lesson of the Day podcast, we talked about Anna trying to be a genie. That's spelled G-E-N-I-E. In Lesson 34 of the Let's Learn English series. A genie has special magical powers. Anna thinks these include the power to read people's minds. To read minds means to know what other people are thinking.
We should add that in Let's Learn English, Anna meets a genie who does have some magical powers. But this genie only gives Anna some special genie clothes. She does not give Anna magical powers.
Anna was dressing like a genie for Halloween, a popular tradition in the United States celebrated on October 31st. People dress as scary creatures such as monsters or ghosts, or as any other special thing or person.
Anna discovers she is not very good at reading people's minds. So at first, she uses the word might because she is not sure. But when Anna says might, this makes people worry about what will happen to them in the future. Let's listen to this part of Lesson 34.
Can you really read minds?
I might.
Well, today I will ask my girlfriend to marry me. What am I thinking?
Wait. Wait. You are thinking you might have a wedding very soon.
Might? Might? She won't say no. Will she?
No, no. She will say yes.
I will have a wedding, won't I?
You will. You will.
Thanks. I think.
Good luck!
Anna had to predict or say what she thinks will happen in the future.
You know, Lesson 34 of Let's Learn English made me think about predictions and about chance, which means how likely it is something will or will not happen. And it reminded me of two conversations I recorded with Faith Perlow, who writes Ask a Teacher and Everyday Grammar articles on the Learning English website. Faith and I talked about making predictions.
Did she try to read your mind?
No, she's not a genie, but she is a teacher, and we made the recording to explain some expressions.
Oh, now I'm curious. Let's hear it.
Okay. Here's our first conversation.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Faith.
So, Andrew, do you have any plans for the weekend?
I do. I'm going to play tennis tomorrow.
You are? I think it's supposed to rain.
Really? I thought it was supposed to be good.
Let me check my phone. Okay. So it says there's a 30% chance in the morning and 90% later in the day.
Well, I play in the morning, so those are pretty good odds. Though the odds of me winning are not very good.
Why? Are you playing with somebody really good?
Yeah, he's good. I can practice with him fine, but in a match, I have to play my best, and he has to play kind of poorly for me to have a chance. So it's very unlikely I'll win, but it's still super fun either way.
Well, it sounds like you have a 100% chance of fun.
That's right. As long as it doesn't rain.
And here's our second conversation.
So, Faith. I notice there really are a lot of ways to talk about what we think might happen in the future.
That's right. We're talking about what's likely to happen. So we talk about the odds or the chances.
Odds and chances are basically the same thing?
Yes. If we say, what are the odds of, or what are the chances of, we are asking how likely something is to happen.
And talking about the percent chance, math and science tend to use the word probability.
That's right. It's used a lot in the sciences and mathematics to talk more precisely about the chances.
So we can say something is probable or likely. Probable is an adjective. Or instead, we can say something will probably happen. Probably is an adverb. And we can talk about the probability of an event. Probability is a noun.
And I hope our listeners notice that we add the preposition of after the noun probability. We say the probability of something.
Just like we say the odds of something or the chances of something.
Well, Andrew, I hope this was helpful for our listeners.
Me too. Chances are it was helpful for at least some people.
And what about your tennis game? How did it go?
Well, I said I was unlikely to win, and that prediction was correct.
But it was still super fun?
It was. But winning might be even more fun.
Ah, better luck next time.
Thanks. Though I think I need more than luck. I need to practice.
We all need to practice things we are learning or things that take skill, especially when you're learning a language.
Right, like learning English.
Yeah, and you know, speaking of predictions, we can also talk about the word weather.
You mean the rain?
No, not that kind of weather, spelled W-E-A-T-H-E-R. I mean the other word, spelled W-H-E-T-H-E-R. Like when we want to know whether or not something will happen.
Yes, and here's a good detail for people learning English to notice. It's more common to say the word if than whether. For example, we typically say, I want to know if it's going to rain.
But we can use whether when we want to clearly state two or more different possibilities. For example, we might say, I need to know whether my car has a problem with its battery or with its engine.
So, whether you find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or our website, learningenglish.voanews.com, we hope you have enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast.
And thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.